Good evening, everyone, and welcome to yet another episode of Coffee with Steve, which means I answer all of your questions which you have posted during the week, which you have posted the previous week, which I wasn't able to answer, but I'm answering all of them in this video. My name is Steve and welcome to my channel, and if you're new to this channel, make sure to hit that subscribe button so that you don't miss any videos. And if you do find any value while I answer all of these questions, make sure to hit that like button and also make sure to post your question for the next Coffee with Steve episode. So I will not make this any longer, which means let's dive into all of these questions which you guys have posted. So question number one comes in from Action8 and he asks, "Hi Steve, can you make a video about concurrency patterns in Go?" Yes, my friend, I'm currently working on a video regarding concurrency in Go and everything you need to know about concurrency. So the first thing you want to pay attention is the good and the bad ways of using concurrency in Go, because there are certainly ways of using concurrency in Go the wrong way, which is why I will try and talk about that in the video which is coming up. And of course, there are patterns like fan in, fan out, like making use of those Go routines which Go gives you. Also, another thing which I think you need to pay attention to is knowing the different kind of features which Go gives you when it comes to concurrency. You know, things like channels, like goroutines, like mutexes, atomics, and all that stuff. And it's very important to not misuse the features which Go gives you. The concurrency may get in the way, so it's important to know how to use concurrency correctly. There are things which you may want to run concurrently. There are other things which you don't want to run concurrently. So the next question comes in from GamingBeast36, and he's asking, "Do you have any tips to write faster code?" So when it comes to running faster code, obviously you want to make use of those concurrency features which Go gives you. You want to run code in parallel if that's a possibility for you. You want to make use of the workhorse performance which Go gives you. And the next question comes in from Marat Ermeshev, and he's asking, "Hi, also have a question about writing faster code. How to use eBPF or BPF for Go applications? I was wondering if I can ask a practical example where I can repeat all the step by step." Well, quite frankly, this is something new for me. I had to Google it in order to understand what exactly is this eBPF stuff. But a couple of things you need to know about this tool, as far as I'm concerned, as far as I Googled it, is it's not really meant to run code faster. It's really meant more for like debugging purposes, tracing purposes, and all that stuff. Also, another thing you need to know about this eBPF tool is the fact that it runs on Go, which means it's probably not safe to use. You have to take care, because with great power comes great responsibility, so it's all on your own. You have to take care of that yourself. And also, speaking of cross-platform or cross-platform compatibility, I'm not sure it works on all systems, because as far as I read, it says Linux or Unix-like systems. I'm pretty sure the Go debugging tools are pretty much sufficient for most people out there. I'm not sure I will use this tool. I'll have a look at this tool later on and see how we can integrate Go workflows, if you will. But other than that, make sure to check that out yourself. I'll link all of the resources in the video description. Make sure to check out the video description where you can find more about this eBPF tool. Alrighty, so the next question comes in from the same guy, GamingBeast36, and he's asking, "What is the difference between concurrency and parallelism?" A very good question, my friend, which quite frankly, a lot of people confuse the two. So to put it out simpler for you, concurrency is about dealing with a lot of things at the same time, but parallelism is doing a lot of things at the same time, dealing versus doing. So now, if we're talking about like in technical terms, concurrency is really running a bunch of tasks on a single core, running a bunch of tasks and context switching between all of these tasks back and forth, depending on which task is more important, which task has more CPU burst, and a bunch of different priorities which the CPU has. Parallelism, on the other hand, is executing a bunch of tasks in parallel on multiple cores and all that stuff. So because you got multiple cores, multiple resources, you can run that program in parallel, but also on that single core which you're running a group of tasks, you may run different or a bunch of tasks, which means your program can also be concurrent. So that, my friends, is the difference between concurrency and parallelism. Hopefully this makes it clear for everyone, but don't worry too much about it. I'll cover everything in the concurrency video, which, as I said, it's coming up. The next question comes in from, again, Marat Ermeshev, and he's asking, "May you make an overview of the best companies for Go developers?" Well, obviously FANG, which stands for like Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google, is the two Go companies, is like the dream companies for pretty much every developer out there. But you're not really like limited or supposed to, you know, dream about these companies and work for these companies. So what I would advise you instead is to focus on your experience and focus on your own knowledge. And also make sure to have fun and constantly learn, because the software engineering business is a constantly learning business. And to open up a little small secret, I never actually applied for a job for a company. I always got recommended. Ever since I got my first job, I always got recommended by somebody else. I don't really focus too much on applying. I don't focus too much on working for somebody. I try and focus on myself. I try and focus on my knowledge, my own experience, constantly learning and doing all the things that I mentioned above. And jobs and companies kind of land on their own. That's why I try and focus on these things. And trust me, you will get tons of jobs. You'll get tons of companies reaching out to you. So yeah, do your best, man, and let me know if all of these advices helped you. Alrighty, moving on to the next question coming in from Kishore, and he's asking, I'm thinking of making a BitTorrent client in Go. Do you have any tips slash suggestions slash guide references for doing that? Just like building really anything that you would want, including a BitTorrent client. Just look at the market, look at popular libraries, popular clients already developed, and have a look at how they're done. Have a look at the implementation, at what libraries they used, how they used it, and all that stuff. So as I said before, I've never implemented a BitTorrent client. I did not need to do that, and I'm not sure I will. But if you do build your BitTorrent client, make sure to send that link to me personally. I'll check it out and give you a shout out. So the next question comes in from Max Muster, and he's asking, what's the best library for caching Redis in Go? And should you regularly store data from database in cache for speed and redundancy database latency? If there are any official libraries, try and use the official libraries. If there are no official libraries, try and use the ones which are most popular, because they are popular for a reason, obviously. So the one that I personally have used and the one that I recommend is Go Redis, which is, I believe, is the official library for Redis. But yeah, if you don't like it or feel like using something else, do so, as long as it solves the problem. And now back to the second part of your question, if you should store data from database all the time so that you can speed up the process while accessing all that data. Well, the answer to that question is really no. Redis is not always a good fit for like every case. What you should really ask yourself first is if you really do need Redis, or maybe you could use something simpler, something which is lighter, something like Memcached, for example. Redis is just a heavier database for caching, in my opinion, and this is why I recommend using, if you have like simple data, just strings, key value pairs, try and use Memcached instead of Redis. Also, if you're trying to use this distributed cache mechanism for like concurrent purposes, try and use Memcached, because Memcached supports concurrency. Not all the times you would need a distributed cache. If you are in the situation where you need this to be distributed, I don't know, you're having like multiple microservices and they are all making use of this cached data instead of accessing the database, or instead of firing a lot of requests to one specific service, yes, it might be a good case. But if you're just implementing caching on a specific service and it's not really reused, probably a distributed cache is not the best option. Just stick to a good old in-memory cache, and there are lots of implementation for that, and it's pretty easy to even implement it yourself. The next question comes in from Arat0R, and he's asking, as a former JavaScript developer, any thoughts about combining growth in Go and JavaScript? So the first thing that I did in order to learn Go, in order to boost my knowledge in Go while being a JavaScript developer, because obviously you can't really make the transition that fast, the first thing that I did is really creating a YouTube channel. I created a YouTube channel in order to teach people Go, even though I was coding in JavaScript back then. Why did I do so? Because, as you all know, teaching somebody else or teaching a group of people requires much more knowledge, requires a bigger amount of preparation, which means you will learn much more than, you know, doing traditional learning. This is why this is the way that I kind of combined my career in JavaScript with teaching Go and maintaining my knowledge in regards to Go programming language. Another thing, of course, to keep up your knowledge while being a JavaScript developer, try and you know, work on interesting projects, projects that you're having fun with, projects which are complex, which would teach you a lesson when it comes to Go specifically. And lastly, what I recommend is try and get a job. If you want to be a Go developer, then be a Go developer. Don't try and limit yourself. Alrighty, the next question comes in from Cesar VSPR, and he's asking where a newbie can be paid to program with Go. Well, let me be honest with you. Let me give you a simple and honest answer about this question. Most Go developers out there didn't start with Go. Probably they come from different languages with already a bunch of experience behind them. And in fact, most companies out there don't even test you on Go. They don't even look for you to have Go experience because they know if you are a professional, if you are a senior software engineer, you will pick up Go easily, you will understand what's happening, and you'll just adjust very easy. You know, by being a newbie, as you described in the question, you can't really get a job when it comes to Go because, as I said before, companies don't really care about your Go experience. They care about your you being a professional, your experience overall, which means you have to be experienced. You're either experienced or you're not. It doesn't really matter if you know Go or if you are coming from a different language. So the next question comes in from Henrik Alexandre, and he's asking, "Hi Steve, could you explain please in a few comments what is the criteria we need to follow to implement TDD or test-driven development when it comes to Go code?" So my answer is don't, and let me tell you why. First of all, TDD or test-driven development is really a myth in my opinion. It's really something which doesn't work in real life because requirements change too fast. Requirements a lot of the times are not present, a lot of the times are not complete, or the clients just don't know what they want, which makes it very hard for you to implement TDD. Also, when it comes to testing, a lot of you know that companies out there are really tough, are really hard on allowing you, giving you time in order to test your code, because as all of us know, testing is about 2/3 of the actual work. The actual implementation, the actual work takes about 1/3, and the actual testing takes about 2/3, and that's regular testing when everything is done, when everything is like complete, the job is done, now you're doing testing. That's going to take you twice or three more times amount of time in order to test your code. And we're not even talking about TDD, because TDD is going to require you even more time. You're going to waste even more time because you're going to move back and forth between the tests and between the implementation. What I usually do, I like to have it work. First of all, after I have an implementation which works, I try to make this beautiful. After that, I try to cover it with tests. And when I'm trying to focus only on testing after everything has been already implemented, I am sharper, I can think clearer, and I can find bugs and backdoors in my code easier when I'm doing only testing, as opposed to doing a lot of context switching and moving back and forth between the implementation and the testing. Another question comes in from Garushia FM. He's asking, "In the last Go updates, look like there were some changes on the mod. Could you talk a little bit about it?" Yes, you are right, my friend. With the recent update of Go 1.16, there are a couple of things new to the language, including or affecting the Go modules as well. So let's talk a little bit about those. And the first change when it comes to Go modules is the fact that you have module aware feature by default available, regardless of the fact if you have a go.mod file in your project or you don't. You automatically have module aware features, which means if you run something like go get or any go command which makes use of modules, it will automatically be module aware. The go install command now also has this module aware feature, which means you can install global binaries and you can install versions of those global binaries, and this is really cool in my opinion. And yeah, that's already available inside Go 1.16, as I said. The build and test commands now don't affect the Go mod file as it used to, as you could see in my video when it comes to Go modules. So if you don't know what Go modules really are, for now, make sure to check out that video right here. But as you will see in that video, I have an example where I show you that Go test and Go build and really any Go command affects the Go mod file. And yeah, as of these updates in 1.16, it will not affect the files anymore. You will have to run Go mod tidy in order to make those changes, in order to affect your go.mod file. Moving on with the features, there is a new directive called retract, so you can use that directive called retract. Again, I'm not going to dive into details what exactly that is and stuff like that. I will cover that in the newly updated video. So yeah, these are pretty much the changes when it comes to Go modules in Go 1.16. As I said before, I'll back everything up with a video in regards to all of these updates when it comes to Go modules, so that people are up to date and they don't get confused by the older video. All right guys, the last question comes in from Tudor Teleki, and he's asking, "How much does your filming equipment cost, including cameras and drone, etc.?" Well, to give you a very short answer on this question, it's above $10,000. But hear me out, it wasn't like that in the beginning. In the beginning, I had a setup which was under $1,000. I had a 5 $100 camera, I believe. I had a microphone which was about $200. I had a couple of cheap soft boxes and lights and a green screen, and that was about it. It wasn't like that. I didn't have free cameras as I do right now. And let me tell you something else. I've been investing all of my money for the last 3.5 years in YouTube, in gear, in cameras, in lights, microphones, and all that stuff. So it wasn't as crazy as it may sound for some of you. I want to tell you one more thing. It doesn't matter what kind of gear you have. Yes, the gear can make your content better, but at the end of the day, what matters more is the person behind the gear, the person behind the camera, the person who's telling the story. So before we wrap up this video, I wanted to give a small shout out to my newly joined patrons. Quick shout out for Mar Erm or Marat Ermeshev, who has become my patron, and also huge shout out for Sen Galanto, who has also become my patron. And yeah, these are people who believe in my dreams. These are people who believe in this thing, in this YouTube channel. And speaking of this YouTube channel, I recently gave up my full-time job. That's why if you feel like contributing, make sure to check out that Patreon page over there. Also, if you want to stay in touch with me and the community, make sure to check out the Discord community, where we have a vibrant community. We started to grow a little bit more than usual, and things are going more actively on Discord community, more actively than in the comments on YouTube. That's why make sure to check out that Discord community as well. And yeah, also make sure to hit that like and share button if you found any value by the end of this video, and also hit that subscribe button if you're not part of this community already. And yeah, guys, without too much further ado, I'll see you in the next video.